What's up, Cathedral? What's up? Would you take your Bibles or your electronic devices, although it's, I think, unspiritual to use them, your electronic devices, and please turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, one of my favorite passages. It's a passage that's sort of sandwiched between two mentions of the second coming of Jesus. We'll get to that in a second. Starting off, though, I want to read an article that I came across a long time ago in the Omaha World Herald on Saturday, August 20th, 1988. And the headline says, San Jose, a stir at forecast of September 11 second coming. This, by the way, is before September 11, 2001. Okay? The article says, thousands of San Francisco Bay Area Christians are being convinced that the end of the world may be at hand. Sunday, September 11 is the date for the beginning of the end, according to Edgar Wisenant, a born-again Christian from Little Rock, Arkansas. He swept through the South Bay last weekend preaching that the rapture, Christ's second coming, will begin on Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year. He also predicted that World War III, a 37-week nuclear confrontation between the United States and the Soviet Union, will begin at sunrise, October 4. He says a nuclear winter will continue until the final judgment in November of 1995, and it will be followed by the millennium, a thousand-year reign of Christ on earth, beginning December 25th, 1995. The effect of this kind of doomsday message is disastrous, said the Reverend Emmanuel Canistraci, pastor of the Thousand-Member Evangel Christian Center in San Jose. If you think Jesus is coming and you have a $10,000 credit limit on your Visa card, you're going to charge it to the limit. I received Wisenant's book in the mail 2 or 3 months ago, and I put it aside, never read it. I thought it was a joke. But then deacons, elders, and members of my congregation started picking up on it, and now some people in my church are thinking about doing some really stupid things, quitting their jobs, selling their homes, spending all their money. He said he has been counseling members of his congregation who have taken the message too seriously. He said other pastors around the country are having similar problems. Wisenand is drawing a national following by distributing books and broadcasting on about 80 radio stations. He drew more than 3,000 people to Jubilee Christian Church in Milpitas, that's a California name, I guess, last Friday. Over the weekend, the church sold 10,000 copies of his book, On Borrowed Time, 88 Reasons Why the Rapture Could Be in 1988, published in June by some publishing company. Wisenant, who claims to be a retired engineer for NASA, seems to have reached his doomsday conclusion through a combination of numerology, history, scriptural analysis, and citations from sources as varied as the Defense Department materials, scientist Carl Sagan, and ultra-radical Rabbi Meir Kahan. To the best of my knowledge, I don't think Jesus came in 1988. I don't think he came then. I can tell you when he is not going to come. He's not going to come whenever a person says a particular date that he's going to come. He's not going to come on that day. He's going to come later than that. He's going to come some other time. Do you know that nobody knows the time of that? It says that in Matthew 24. Jesus says that. Jesus says, not even he knows the time or the day. God had not revealed that to him in his humanity, which is how Jesus usually functioned when he was incarnate. So he doesn't even know. So how does Edgar Wisenant think he knows when it is? By the way, after this, he realized when the dates passed, he recalculated everything, and he said he didn't factor in the 150 days that you get from Noah's Ark, and so he projected another time, and it didn't happen then either. Well, I know that there have been other movements kind of like his in the history of the world, and sometimes people have done some really amazing and really foolish things. There was a movement like this sort of in Korea about 30 years ago. And literally the Koreans who were involved in this They sold their houses. They gave all their possessions away. They put on white robes. They went up on the top of their houses, waiting for the morning in which it was told them that Jesus would come back, and they're waiting to be raptured, and it never happened. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, starting at verse 13, and going through chapter 5, verse 11, the Apostle Paul talks about the prophetic theme of the rapture of the church. And so our context of our passage, verses 12 through 18, comes with that context before, but it also comes in the context afterwards. Take a look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. It says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Okay? So sandwiched between that, we have this passage. And in this passage, the Apostle Paul sort of unpacks how it is we ought to be living in light of the second coming of Jesus. Should we be selling our houses, maxing out our Visa cards? Should we be doing all kinds of radical things? No. What we're going to find is some very basic things that we ought to be doing in light of Jesus coming back. All right, so here we go. In this passage, Paul prescribes the correct actions toward three different groups of people, how we ought to be treating them in light of the rapture of the church. The first one that we find here is an action, or the actions toward church leaders. So Paul says in chapter 5, verse 12, "We ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work." And then he says, "Be at peace among yourselves." And so there is actually here at the start of this, this very strong statement here that we are to respect those who labor among you. The word respect is translated by the NASB as to acknowledge. The word is literally to know them. And what is it specifically? It's those who do three things. They diligently labor among you, have charge over you, and give you instruction. They diligently labor. They work hard. Now, I want to suggest this is especially intended for the rank and file in church and what their attitudes ought to be toward the leaders in their church. And I'm thinking especially, you know, your deacons here. You don't have an elder right now from Cathedral, but you will soon enough. And your campus pastor and a host of others who diligently serve the Lord here by serving you. And notice that they are to respect them, they're to appreciate them. Literally, they're to know them. And why are they to know them and respect them and appreciate them? It's because they labor among you. They labor diligently is the idea. It looks at the laboriousness of one's work, the exhaustion that can result. And they have charge over you. The word charge, or those who are over you in the Lord. By the way, I just have to explain. I shouldn't do this. I brought the wrong notes this morning. I brought notes based upon the New American Standard instead of the ESV. And so some of this might sound a little bit different. Don't get too worried. It all ends up in the same place. I just wanted to say that. If it doesn't sound quite like what you have in your Bible or electronic device, that's okay. Okay, so you're to respect those, appreciate them, know them, who labor among you. That is, they're working hard, and they are over you in the Lord and admonish you. The word "over you" means to stand at the front of something and provide leadership and direction for it. Same word is used in 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 4, referring to the elders. Paul writes, "He must be one," that is the person who would be an elder, "he must be one who manages his own household well." Same word as we have here for being over you in the Lord. And they admonish you. The word "admonish" doesn't just mean to teach. Sometimes it means to confront lovingly using Scripture in the confrontation. And we live in a culture and a society today that hates confrontation. And yet part of leadership in the church involves leaders who occasionally, at least, we'll be able to come up to somebody who needs to be admonished and appeal to them, reprove them, show them with Scripture, teach them how they ought to be living. So we should be welcoming those things from our church leaders when it happens. And so they give us instruction. These are the things that these people do and why they should have our respect. So they're laboring, involving caring for people. They're leading. By the way, how would you like to come and lead Cathedral? How would you like to come here and move the church from point A to point B, to come up with those ideas? Let's just say, and I don't know that this is the case, but it probably is in most evangelical churches. Let's suppose you need to move from point A, where not much evangelism is happening, to point B, where a lot's happening. How would you like to be over a group and you're responsible to see that that comes about under the Lord's providence? It's not a fun thing. Now, what I'm about to say, I'm a little bit embarrassed that Jeff Thompson is here this morning, because I want to rave about him just a little bit. And I thought he wasn't going to be here. You know, everybody else is on sabbatical. They're scraping the bottom of the barrel. There was nobody else to preach at all of Harvest except me. And so they asked me to do this. But Jeff's here today. That guy works hard for you. I have enormous respect for Jeff Thompson, and I love Jeff Thompson. But the times that that's good. The times that we've gotten together, he has talked about the kinds of things that's going on with you folks and the sort of programs and needs and individual concerns that some of you had without sharing your names with me. He really cares for you guys. He wants to see the best happen for this congregation. And he should be respected for that. Now, by the way, he's never said to me, my church doesn't respect me. He's never said that. And so what I'm saying may be irrelevant, but I'm here to tell you this is what the Word says. It says in verse 13, you're to esteem them very highly in love because of their work, because of the labor in which they serve. So he says also then, at the end of verse 13, be at peace among yourselves. Paul there begins to broaden it a little bit. First part of verse 12 and 13, he begins to address our attitudes towards church leaders, people who are active in serving our church. And then he begins to broaden it at the end of verse 13, where he says, be at peace among yourselves. And so he opens it up. And we're going to get to that in a second, talking about how Christians ought to be treating just other Christians, not just leadership. But I want to tell you a little story. I have a friend of mine who is now on the theology staff, the faculty staff at John Piper's seminary. And he pastored a church not very far from where I was in Illinois here. He was there for 7 years. It was a struggle. That church was a troubled church. And one time he lamented to me, not really a complaint, but more of just a comment, that the church never once engaged in Pastor Appreciation Month. Now, you guys may not have heard of that. I think James Dobson started it a long time ago. But what he decided was that he should make it sort of known that churches should take the month of October and express their appreciation to their staff, especially, and their other leaders. And my friend never once in 7 years had his church do that for him. I think that's really sad. I have at home an appreciation file that my wife has kept over the years. There were times when I was pastoring. I was a pastor for 17 years full-time, part-time, you know, probably 1,000 years in other churches. So, but my wife has kept an appreciation file so that when I'm having really down days related to ministry, she would trot this thing out and have me read some of the notes. And they were encouraging, expressed appreciation and gratitude for things that I'd done for people. 17 years of pastoral ministry, there are 11 notes in that file. Only 11 notes. I'm not bitter about that. Nobody gets into ministry because of all the appreciation they're going to get. But it was interesting that that, you know, either I wasn't doing a very good job, which is definitely a possibility, or they were just very uncaring. So let me just suggest that you guys, every one of you, if you appreciate Jeff Thompson, his leadership, Luke's leadership here, the other leaders in the church who are so actively involved, do something concrete for them. Somebody has said that our appreciation for somebody is only as sincere as the effort we make to express it. So keep that in mind. Now, here's how we ought to be treating other Christians, okay? He starts in verse 14. And we urge you, brothers, okay, remember the end of verse 13, be at peace among yourselves. And so now he opens it up. So for actions and attitudes in light of the rapture of the church toward other people in our church, other Christian friends. And we urge you, brethren, admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with them all. This is written to you and me. This is not written to the church leadership. This is written to us. And so we need to be involved. We need to be helping out. We urge you, brothers, as Paul is exhorting now, that you admonish the idle. And the word idle here means those who are out of step. The idea was, basically it meant that, well, back in those days, when the Roman soldiers would go out and go march, and they would march in rank and file, in order. Somebody got out of step, they used this word for that. And so now we're talking about living the Christian life, and somebody begins to sort of not have such a good manifestation of the presence of Jesus. We're walking with him. He gets out of step with the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. Guess what? Our job is to go to them and talk to them and appeal to them. We should care enough for them that we would go and do that on their behalf. He also says that we need to encourage the faint-hearted. The word faint-hearted literally means to the timid, the weak, those who are discouraged, perhaps due to persecutions. Verbal support and help is suggested here. And the idea of helping the weak, the word help means literally to take hold of somebody, suggesting more deliberate support of the weak, those who are emotionally, spiritually, financially, or physically weak. The late theologian Irma Bombeck, who some of you may have heard of, she was sort of a humorous writer, wrote a very interesting article once upon a time reflecting her own failure in just the area of being kind to somebody. She writes, "It was one of those days when I wanted my own apartment unlisted. My son was telling me in complete detail about a movie he had just seen, punctuated by 3,000 you knows. My teeth were falling asleep. In the cab from the home to the airport, I got another assault on my ear, this time by a cab driver who was rambling on about his son, whom he supported in college and was in his last year, who put a P.S. on a letter saying, 'I got married, her name is Diane.' He asked me, 'What do you think about that?' and proceeded to answer the question himself. There were 30 whole beautiful minutes before my plane took off, time for me to be alone with my own thoughts, to open a book, let my mind wander. A voice next to me, belonging to an elderly woman, said, 'I'll bet it's cold in Chicago.' Stone-faced, I answered, 'It's likely.' 'I haven't been to Chicago in nearly 3 years,' she persisted. 'My son lives there.' 'That's nice,' said Irma, my eyes intent on the printed page of my book. 'My husband's body is on this plane. We've been married for 53 years. I don't drive. You know, when he died, a nun drove me from the hospital home. And we weren't even Catholic. The funeral director let me come to the airport with him.' Irma says, 'I don't think I have ever detested myself more than I did at that moment. Another human being was screaming to be heard and in desperation had turned to a cold stranger who had more interest in a novel than in the real-life drama at her elbow. All she needed was a listener, no advice, wisdom, experience, money, assistance, expertise, even compassion, but just a minute or two to listen. It seemed rather incongruous that in a society of super sophisticated communication, we often suffer from a shortage of listeners. She talked numbly and steadily until we boarded the plane, then found her seat in another section. As I hung up my coat, I heard her plaintive voice say to her seat companion, "I'll bet it's cold in Chicago." I prayed, "Please, God, let that other person listen to her." And then she writes, "Why am I telling you this? To make me feel better. It won't help, though." Guys, my thought is that in the body of Christ, there are scores and scores and tons of people who are really hurting. If we find out about that pain, we should do something about it. It can be enormously helpful for them and might provide an incredible ministry. So he goes on. We're to help the weak and be patient with them all. Verse 15, see that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. It's so common. I see so many Christians anymore that when somebody hurts them or offends them, that another believer, they want to go after them. They want to post negative things about them on social media. They want to sue them in secular courts. They want to do all kinds of horrible things to them. And I'm thinking, have we read this verse? So somebody stomps on our toes. What are we to do? We're not to repay evil for evil, but we're to seek a way to do good. Let me just suggest, if somebody's been really nasty to you, first of all, if they've done something criminal to you, call the cops. Okay? Call the cops. If it's something less than that, and they've hurt you, somehow you have to be able to figure out how to forgive them, and the Lord will help you do that. Even if they don't ask for forgiveness, I think we need to forgive them. And then my suggestion is to overcome evil with good. When it comes about that they encounter hardship and difficulty and tragedy in their lives, you go and serve them. You go to them and minister to them. I know of a church in Korea, used to be the biggest church in the world. And their pastor just suggested, look, if somebody down the street has some sort of a hardship, take them a gift, a little gift, and just tell them that you'll be praying for them. And he said it was doing that more than anything else that caused their church to grow, that the Lord used to have their church grow. So let me suggest that somebody's been bad to you. Romans chapter 12 says we're to return a blessing for a curse. I don't think when somebody does nasty to us right at that second, we look at them and go, "Oh, God bless you." I don't think that's what he's talking about. I don't think we do that right at that moment. But sometime we look for the opportunity to do something kind. We overcome evil with good. Not easy to do, by the way. And he also says, the end of verse 15, see that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another, that is to other Christians, and to everyone. So now he widens it even further. The first couple of verses, our attitudes toward Christian leaders. The next couple of verses, our attitude toward other Christians, our Christian friends. Now he starts to talk about our attitude toward unbelievers. And we have the three little verses here, which if you're ever involved in a D group and you haven't done your scripture memory for the week, one of these will work. It's great. Rejoice evermore. There, you got a verse memorized. There you go. Use that in your D group. It'll work. Should work. Paul says, verse 16, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Now, those verses don't just plop down without a context. They absolutely have a context. You need to remember the historical situation of the Thessalonian church. In Acts chapter 17, and we're not going to go there, I'm just going to summarize it for you. In Acts 17, the Jewish people were initially receptive to the message that Paul, Silas, and Timothy brought and preached to them. But then they began to oppose those Christians, those preachers, very forcefully, so much so that Paul had to flee to Berea. And later, people from Thessalonica came down to Berea and stirred up some of the Bereans against Paul. And so now we've got this little church, brand new church, in the middle of this incredible hot spot, a hot spot of persecution and antagonism to the gospel. Also, you don't have to turn, but let me just read. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 4 to 6, Paul says, "Therefore we ourselves speak proudly of you among the churches of God, for your perseverance and faith in the midst of all your persecutions and afflictions which you endure. This is a plain indication of God's righteous judgment, so that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God, for which indeed you are suffering. For after all, it is only just for God to repay with affliction those who afflict you." And so this church is in the middle of this enormous this enormous sort of conflict in their community. And so what does Paul say? He says to that group who's in that sort of a setting, "Rejoice evermore." Right. Right. Pray without ceasing. Okay, there's some very interesting parallels here. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 11 and 12, you don't have to go there. Jesus says, "Blessed are you when men cast insults at you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice," same word is here, "and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." So one of the reasons why we rejoice when we're persecuted is because we're in really good company. We're in the same company as the prophets who got persecuted and stood for God so strongly. So we're to rejoice evermore, even though we're suffering. God might use the very persecution against us to maybe pick their conscience. If they see you hanging on to Jesus so strong, they might think to themselves, maybe there's something in this Christianity that my Christian acquaintance would hang on to Jesus, even though we're beating him up literally or figuratively. So we're to rejoice always. We're to pray without ceasing. Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. Same context as what we saw here. "Rejoice and be glad, your reward is great in heaven," Matthew 5:12. Matthew 5:44, "But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing. When do we pray? When people are nasty to us, when people are persecuting us or hurting us. We pray, and we pray for them all the time. And I'm here to tell you, this takes the Spirit, because our nature is prone to want to retaliate and repay evil for evil, and we mustn't. And then he says in verse 18, "Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." It's his will that we would give thanks in all circumstances. And I take it that one of the reasons why we can give thanks is that at the same time, God is developing us, our endurance, our compassion for those who don't deserve it. And he's also in some way bringing glory to himself as we respond correctly to the kind of opposition and persecution that he's coaching them about here. I had another friend of mine who was a pastor who one year made a New Year's resolution that he was going to rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and give thanks in all circumstances. He made the New Year's resolution that he was going to do that. He was going to give thanks in all circumstances. But then a woman came into his office right after the first of the year, and she attacked him like crazy. She said, "I don't like your hair. I don't like your preaching. I don't like your clothes. I don't like your family. I don't like your car. I don't like your ministry." And then she stormed out of the office. And you can imagine how that affected him. And so he sat there and he thought, Lord, I've made this New Year's resolution, but how am I going to thank you in this situation? And then it came to him, and he said out loud, Lord, I thank you that she's not my wife. Always find something to thank the Lord in, right? All right, I just want to end up with a couple of things and then another real short story. I want to suggest that you send your pastor or other significant Christian leader here at Cathedral this week a note, at least a note of appreciation, at least. And if he gets 120, praise Jesus. I think he deserves it. And the other leaders here too, referring to Jeff Thompson. And then also, let me just suggest that you might take somebody out for coffee who you know is having a hard time. They're being beat up by life, by others around them, circumstances. Don't ever underestimate the power of a considerate, kind word. So I want to just conclude with a little story here, and it's maybe a little bit trite and a little bit cliche, but I love this story. There was a man named Father Flanagan, a Roman Catholic priest. He was the founder of Boys Town, the Boys Town Orphanage in Omaha, Nebraska. And in 1922, he heard of two homeless and parentless little boys who were going to be coming to live at Boys Town in Omaha. They were coming on the train. So he went down to the train station to meet them, but he was a little bit late getting there. And as he got there, he saw the older brother and the bigger brother carrying his exhausted little brother piggyback. Father Flanagan said, he's pretty heavy, isn't he? And the boy, squinting through the bright sun, looked at Flanagan and said, he ain't heavy, he's my brother. The Hollies made that a hit song in the 1960s. You should check it out, it's a great song. Based upon this episode, to the people in our church who are having a hard time, they're not heavy, they're our brother. We ought to be doing such things for them. So this is how we're to live in the shadow of the coming of Christ, the rapture of the church. We're to love our leaders, we're to serve our Christian friends, and we're to pray for our non-Christian acquaintances and our sphere of influence. In other words, basically what it comes down to, just do the same old stuff you were always supposed to do in light of the rapture of the church. Just keep doing it. That's how the Lord wants us to live. Don't have to sell your house. Don't have to quit your job. Don't have to give away your car. Just keep doing what you've always been doing for the Lord. You guys got it? Amen. If you got it, would you just nod your head so I know you're still awake? Oh, you don't have to do that. Don't ever clap for me. It's that makes me arrogant, so don't ever do that. Let's pray. So, Father, you know, I thank you for this passage, tremendously practical, put in here, sandwiched by references to the rapture of the church, the future coming of Jesus for the church. And I thank you for such practical insights regarding how we ought to live in light of that. And we don't know when that rapture is going to take place, Lord, but what we need to be doing until it does is the same old faithful stuff we've always been doing. And so help us to love each other and to love the non-believers around us even when they don't deserve it. All for your glory. And it'll be a thrill for us too, Lord, as we participate with you in ministering to them in their lives. Make us so, Lord, would you please help us? And all God's people said, amen. There you go.